A disciple, the root word is a learner. Somebody who has a teacher and follows the teacher. So if you are a disciple, you must surrender what you know, open up your brain to learn what the teacher knows. Isn't that true?
Yeah.
If you don't respect the teacher, are you likely to learn?
No.
So it means the beginning point of discipleship is approaching the master, assessing the master, accepting the master, then from then onwards, following him without question. Lots of us, unfortunately, call ourselves Christians, but we are not necessarily disciples. Because we are Christians who have options. In certain areas, we can follow God. In others, we know a little better than him. So we don't follow him. And let me not give the impression I'm talking to you. I also have similar struggles. That certain places, I seem to know how to take care of myself. So I feel like God is interfering in an area I can be master of. But you know, unfortunately, we have sung, I surrender all. The easy areas, the difficult areas, the ones I know, the ones I don't know, I surrender all. I want to suggest to you, as we discuss this subject, that the biggest issue is knowing Jesus. Because if you know him, it's very easy to follow him. Am I right? Yeah, like you go before a doctor and doesn't know what he is doing and he's pulling you apart, he wants to put a needle in you. It's painful even before the needle goes in, isn't it? But when the doctor is called professor and he seems to know what he's doing, he can cut you up. Fortunately, most times you can't see. But he can cut you up and allow you. You're not fighting him. Why? You think he knows what he is doing. As soon as you doubt what he's doing, it's very difficult to cooperate with one who will cause you pain. So the biggest issue is, have you come to a level where you assess yourself thoroughly? Assess your parents thoroughly? Assess your friends thoroughly? And came to a conclusion, none of them can compare to God. Because when that comes, following Jesus becomes something automatic because you know he knows better than you. Once in a while you feel like, on that particular issue, is he really the master of it? Then you remember your assessment and you said, well, even in this, I'm willing to give him because I cannot know as much as he knows. And this morning, I want to ask you something. Is there an area in your life where you feel you know better than God? Which particular area? Where you feel you can manage it? You know, there are many of us who feel like in the area of business, God does not know much. So when it comes to issues with the church, you really go to him. Or because you have had one or two problems in your marriage, or the issues of marriage, you even pray and fast. But in terms of business, you run it yourself. After all, what does Jesus know? He was a carpenter. Now, you need to understand clearly, if that's the way you deal with God, you cannot see, I surrender all. Because on that particular area, you have lots of difficulty accepting himself. But you're not the first one. The disciples had a similar thing. They knew their master was a carpenter. Then they go fishing, and they catch no fish. In the morning, he asks them, have you caught the nothing? So this carpenter tells them, don't worry, don't come out. Go back and put your nets to the left or to the right. They say, see, but this is master. We have been in this business since you were born. And tonight, we were on net the whole night without catching anything. Yeah, because you say it, we'll do it. Do you know the story?
Yes.
When they did what Jesus said, they tried to collect fish. They had to call other boats to help. Remember that story?
Yes.
The carpenter was talking, but the carpenter happened to be Jesus. Am I communicating?
Yes.
Following Jesus begins when you accept him to know and be able to handle every area of your life. Because then you can look at it, look at your MBA in business, and say, even in an MBA, he knows better than me. I'll do it his way. Of course, you can say, but in marriage, what does he know? He was a bachelor, a senior one. Now, surely, exactly how will I involve him in my marriage? What does he actually know? That's before you discover he is a master.
Yes.
Am I communicating?
Yes.
That he is the one. Remember, in Christianity, we don't believe in three gods. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So when Adam was asleep, completely unaware of any need, all he knew was uncomfortable. But he didn't know what the discomfort was all about. The father looked at him and said, it is not good for a man to be. Did Adam know? No. It's God who knew. And then he created a woman suitable for him. Now, so in marriage, you go back and say, I know Jesus or not, you did not marry, but you know you are part of the Godhead. And I want to follow you. No, no, I must send this woman away. She has given me a rough time. But he says, I hate divorce. I say, God, but surely, have you been married? Do you realize what this man is taking me through? This woman will bring me to hospital. Now, surely, God, what are you talking about? Then you remember, he says, it is not good. And although there are challenges within your marriage that clearly indicate that if you went to a judge, he'll say to you. You go to a counselor, he'll tell you why I did you live last year. Now, but you just listen to God. Because you have a choice of listening to the judge or listening to Jesus. You have a choice of listening to the PhD in psychology or listening to Jesus. You even have a choice of listening to yourself or listening to God. And because in your assessment, God knows about marriage more than you, then you are willing to wait. You know, I listened to a testimony by Armstrong. Armstrong was the first man on the moon, if you remember. Those were little older. Remember 1972? The guy went to the, who landed on the moon. He was here in Nairobi, and I was one of the hosting party. And we hosted him at Pan Africa, him sharing his testimony. And of course, he is a top brain, an astronomer. And in addition to that, he was married to a very nice lady. But he was so occupied in his pursuits, because for somebody in his area of science to be able to do his experiments in the moon was the ultimate of the career. So when he was selected, there was such a joy. And for the next number of years preparing to go to the moon, he gave himself totally to the moon and was bright, taken by the whole world. In fact, when he landed on the moon, he started a tour going to speak in various countries, giving experiences to top scientists about the things he had found. But you know, he had already stopped being a good husband well much earlier. The wife was with him, so she's able to share the testimony. He had given up on her, but he wondered, I married him. He is a terrible husband, that is true. But to leave him at this time is unfair to him. He might not make it to the moon and you'll blame me for it. Let me support him. Let me support him until he finally reaches the moon. So he was waiting for him to land, to leave him. And he had already made a conclusion, I have sacrificed enough. But he tells us, she told us when she was here, as she was doing that, she attended a Bible study. Just before he left him, she attended a Bible study. And in the Bible study, she heard about Jesus, who is a master worth following. And that master was not encouraging her to leave her husband. There was such a change in the woman because the marriage was clear. But the man, because one of the crucial, I forgot to mention that, one of the crucial problems is that when he landed on the ground, the president of the U.S. wants to see him. Any president wants to see him, isn't it? But the woman doesn't want to see him to want. What's wrong with her? Doesn't she feel herself privileged to be the wife of such a great man? But for her, she wants to leave him as quickly
as possible.
Now the man, he simply could not fathom what would be a problem with a woman. Like Mother Kimani asked, what does a man want? Now she couldn't understand. That's what she was leaving him. But she discovered Jesus. who knows something about marriage, and she decided before leaving him, she will give Jesus a chance.
Amen.
The woman changed so drastically that the man could tell there was a major difference in the woman. Say, no, I went to a meeting. This top scientist was ready to go for the same meeting. And he finally gave his life to the Lord.
Amen.
Their marriage was saved. And many years later, coming to Nairobi, because he was in Nairobi in the late 90s, many years later from that incident, they were continuing as a united, happy family. That's what Jesus says, isn't it? To become a follower means you know Jesus knows better than you. There's no way you can be the disciple until you assess whether Jesus is worth following. If you are sure he's not worth following, don't waste your time on him. Because his demands are impossible. So unless he is who he says he is, you'll be a fool to follow him. So until you make up your mind that Jesus is God and he is worth following, please don't waste your time. Leave him alone. Because he is saying, if you follow me, you must follow me truly. And you must follow me fully. That's where the songwriter got it from. For example, saying, I agree with him. Jesus says, I want all of you or none of you. I repeat, Jesus wants all of you or none of you. So if you have not fully, if you have given Jesus 99.999, he still says, I either want all of you or none of you. So we are discussing discipleship. Discipleship is following Jesus. And if you are going to follow Jesus, we must follow him fully. Like I was telling the Swahili service, I was really impressed looking at the life of King Saul. King Saul united Israel before David came. And King Saul did a lot of exploits. And King Saul believed in God. But he did not believe that God could be fully followed. Because there are certain things that pragmatism demands you do differently. So, for example, he is told he must go and finish all Amalekites, all of them, and not leave any alive. He realizes God doesn't mean exactly that. It's the poor, the useless guys, they must be killed. But King Agag, surely, it's good to come with you home. He says, all the flocks of the Amalekites must be fully finished. He says, maybe the ones that are there, the fat ones can be spared. You know the story, isn't it? So then he is told to wait for a celebration, for the victory. He is supposed to wait for the priest. But this priest, that is Samuel, does not come on time. And he realizes the soldiers are agitated. So he decides, waited long enough. Although I've never been appointed as a priest, at least as a king, I know something about priesthood. Am I right? Have you had even politicians come to church and start preaching? Yeah, because they feel like if you're a politician, you are know it all. What don't you know? In fact, even the priest needs a little advice. Now, you need to understand that picture is that when you see politicians, of course, the problem is us. We are the ones who allow them to speak in church, isn't it? Hardly any politician bulldozes his way. It's a pastor who allows a politician to speak in a church. In fact, a lot of politicians, when they come in church, and if you are here, forgive me, a lot of politicians, when they come in church, they are looking for opportunity to talk. They are not listening. And they wonder why the sermon is going so long before they start talking. Now, you need to understand clearly, that's the problem of Saul. He was willing to follow, but he wanted to follow God as a king. Unfortunately, in his discipleship, everybody is a student. The teacher is on this side, all the students are on the other side. That is the key is in the congregation, the messenger in the congregation, the memsab in the corridor, we had the memsab is in the congregation, and the boy, you know, the servants who are called boys, same congregation, the master is on this side. So when you come to Jesus, your title disappears. You have no title. You are simply a follower.
Are we together?
Yes.
Your title is meaningless. You are simply a follower.
In the Tutelesa, we used to see that we are equalized by Jesus. You know, there are Tutelesa people here. I got saved in the 60s. That's a song we kept singing.
We are equal. But King Saul did not understand that. He thought that in coming to God, you come with your title. You can't be treated like you don't know when you are such a major person. I'm a professor. If I come to God, surely I cannot be expected to listen like the people who have never gone to school. Now, when it is Jesus you are dealing with, you deal with him without your title. Are we together?
Yes.
You know, these days, we have forgotten who you are. Like I was saying here last time, we have forgotten who you are. You ask someone, who are you? He tells me I'm an engineer. Now, surely, that's not what he is. That's what he does. That's what he does. Who are you? I'm a doctor. That's not what you are. That's what you... We are no longer human beings. We are human doings. Now, so nobody knows who they are because they have become human. You need to understand that as you come to God, you are simply a human being. Created in the image of God. And so as you sit as a follower, that's why I'm allowing people at the end of this service to backslide. Because it's very important that you backslide. Because if you are coming to God with your title, you are wasting your time. And I think it's unfair for you to lose your joy on earth and be in hell later. Now, surely, at least enjoy one of the two. Don't lose both. It's only fair. Because Jesus is saying he wants you to come as you are. And King Saul was made, you understand? He went ahead and started sacrifice. When someone arrived, said, "What? What have you done?" And he was told, "This is not what God wanted." He argued, "What have I done?" Then he was asked by someone, "What is that I'm hearing? The bleating of sheep?" Say, No. Those are fat ones for sacrifice. In other words, when God told him to kill everything, he forgot to ask him to save some for sacrifice. What about Agar? For everything he had an excuse. Please understand clearly. The constitution of Kenya, even 2 years after it was published, is not being amended. The constitution of heaven remains the same. Without any amendment. World without end. The Bible we read was the Bible that was read in 100 AD. The Bible we read was the one that made Martin Luther come out and stand against the Pope. The Bible we read is the same one that made people during the Mau Mau era when I was growing up, knowingly, tell the Mau Maus, we cannot have the two blood. We have the blood of Jesus, we cannot take the blood of goats. They kill one, they think the other is fear. Says, come, we are ready. And they killed one after the other. It's unfortunately, our historians keep writing about, Alexander the Great. They do not write about the various Kikuyus who died during the emergency. Not because they didn't know how to escape it, but they simply say it's better to die than to take all the. Am I communicating?
Yes.
So it's important to understand the critical thing is coming to where you come to God and what matters to him is obedience. Let me read the verse what Samuel actually said. 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 22. But Samuel replied, "Does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as in obeying the voice of the Lord?" To obey is better than sacrifice. And to heed is better than the fat of rams. That's our discussion today. That followers of Jesus are rated not by what they have sacrificed for the ministry, not by the offerings they give, but simply by are they obeying the master.
Yes.
Let me read it again. Does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as in obeying the voice of the Lord? To obey is better than
sacrifice.
So discipleship are followers, not leaders.
Once you agree to be a disciple, you must assess the first point. You must assess whether he is worth following. Once you decide he's worth following, from then onwards, you must follow him without question. I think I'm likely to have said it last time I'm here. When you become a Christian, the last choice you ever make is the choice of Christ. From then onwards, you will never make another choice. My new book just came out. It's written for young people, How to Find a Life Partner. And I'm telling young people, you cannot choose a wife. You ask God who he has already chosen. So you don't sit there. Once you are saved and you are not yet, you are single and you get saved, you will not just lose the chance to choose. Maybe you need to baptize just now. Because if you become a Christian, the Lord will give you whoever he chooses. Are we together?
Yes.
Because you know the best choice is the Lord's choice. So you are willing. So you don't choose. You ask the Lord, who do you want me to marry? Maybe you should pick the book and get the details. But the critical thing is to understand, if you met a man, a boy, and he tells you, me, I cannot marry a Maasai. Never, not me. Don't ask him where he's going. He's on his way to hell. It's very clear. There isn't a debate. Because as soon as you know you have the choice, then you can't be wait for God's choice. Am I right? Yeah. Oh, me. I can never marry a woman taller than me. Not possible. Never. How can I be looking up to a wife? Now, if you are that type, we know where you are going. You are on your way to hell. The day you choose Christ, you will never make another choice. You follow God's choice. But I want to tell you something. The choice God will make for you are not for God's good. They're for your own good. Because Romans 8 is saying, all things that you allow to come into your life, Romans 8:28, will work for good. I became a Christian in the 1960s, and I've seen what it means to walk with the Lord in the 70s, in the 80s, in the 90s, in the first decade of the new millennium, and now we are in the second decade of the new millennium. And I want to tell you, it pays to be a Christian.
Amen.
To follow him, it pays. Not too long ago, a friend of mine asked me, Nanga, are you not lucky? No, they don't know how to say bless. Are you not lucky? And I said, what do you mean? You just got married to Rebecca. I said, Kwan, you didn't get married yourself. Now, he said, you don't understand. We go through hard things. I said, tell me, I don't know. And he told me, it's very tough. By the time I got married, I had two girlfriends, but they didn't know about each other. The question is, how do you trick one to the other? I say, now I agree, I have an easy time. Because I only had Rebecca. Now you need to understand clearly, when you allow the Lord to choose for you, a lot of troubles are gone. He's not asking you to allow him to choose for his own good, it's for your own good. And I've seen that through, not only in my social life, in my business life, I sit and wait and see, wow, God is able to choose. He is able to choose, isn't it? And not only is he able to choose, when he chooses, later you look and it's for your own good. So you need, as a disciple, you need to come to where you are willing to be led, even if initially what he is giving you in your own brain does not look good. Many years later, you look back and be grateful that Romans 8:28 was true. You know, Romans 8:28 does not say all things work good. It only says they work for good. Remove that word for, and many of us will have a quarrel with God. Because next everything, I've been a Christian for more than 40 years, and many things have gone wrong. Some so badly. People say, Nana, what's wrong? Does God care? In fact, one person whispered to me that he thinks I should see a witch doctor. Because he thinks that this thing of Christianity is not working. I've just been transferred to Kisumu, and on my way there, just gotten a brand new car, and it was right off at same hotel. You know, there's an accident called around same hotel as you go to Nakuru. I've never seen it again. It was a right off. But I'm here to tell you that I'm alive. After my car was written off, the insurance did not even discuss it. They just took the wreckage and gave money for the purchase of the new one. And I see if that's not bad enough. After I settled in Kisumu, in July of the same year, I was on duty in Mombasa, flew to Mombasa,
On the way back, I needed to see my mother. I come from Nyandarua. So I stopped in Nairobi, saw my mother, and I came back the same day, Saturday, and I took the early morning Kenya Airways flight to go to Kisumu. That's 1988. Took the early morning flight. And then, as we were going to Kericho, at Kericho is where they start, they're talking about the weather in Kisumu. The guy forgot to talk to us. So the lady started telling us to prepare to land. Then the pilot interfered with her to tell us, welcome. Now, welcome, and she should be telling us goodbye. And I knew what a pilot, what kind of a pilot was this? Anyway, I had good reason to worry, because if you remember, those who are older will remember, it was reported in the press. We crashed into Kisumu Airport. That's July 1988. He forgot to remove the wheels. Because, and I don't understand, we know we keep talking about that God records everything. For pilots, it's a real thing. Because the black box gave us all the discussion. Later, the inspector, the investigator of the accident gave me a chance to see the report. And they take the black box and write it down, everything they said. And because they were two Kikuyu, the senior pilots and the junior were Kikuyus, they were talking in Kikuyu. So the report is like what they said in Kikuyu and what they said in English. And you know what they were talking about? You know what they were talking about? Who is the girlfriend of who? When you are in Cairo, who are in Cairo, who slept with the other? Now, you understand? It's all there in the report. Now, it's all there in the report. That's why, so as you are going down to land, they got a warning. The fork apprenticeship has a warning system. They got a warning to warn them they are coming too low without wheels. Then the senior pilot told them, through the story, by that time was so sweet. The senior pilot told the junior, "What are you going to do? The thing that is warning them against dying, they told the junior one, silence, so the story can continue. So as you are going to land, they were not aware there were no wheels. So we just crashed into the runway. I'm among the very few people alive who crash and lead. Soon after that, one of the Kikuyus who was in Kisumu and was not born again came to visit me. And he says, "Hey, Nana, you need to see someone." I said, "Why?" "You came in a car to crash. Now in a aircraft you crash. Now surely, it's somebody must be." You know, some people think Kikuyus are not expatriates. You know, I was in shock. Because for me, I had wondered what God was with my life. I have a car crash. Totally right off. And the Lord sent me out of it.
Yeah.
"God, you are a great..." I cannot imagine. Now I have an air crash. And very few have ever had air crash and lived. And I'm still alive. "God, I love you."
Amen.
I was thinking, what a loving God I have. The other one is saying, "What a terrible God you are." The facts are the same. The attitude is different. Am I communicating?
Yes.
You know, the songwriter says, "Count your blessings, name them one by..." The devil changes the song. "Count your curses, naming them one by..." And to surprise you, how great the devil is. Now, you need to understand all of that. When you are a disciple, you are conscious somewhere that even in this bad thing, God is in control. And so you know there's something he wants to show you. Something, maybe he wanted me to tell the story in evergreen. That's what happened in 1988. Am I communicating? Because somebody here is going through the same thing. Problems are following each other like tennis ball.
Yes.
And you wonder, surely, where is God? And he needed me to give my testimony so that you know. Romans 8:28 is still... Am I communicating? Maybe the Lord didn't want me to drive the car I was driving. So he writes it off. I get another new car, but a different make. Now, are you getting the point? Now, it's important to understand, when you become a follower, you follow when things are good and when things are bad. Because you know, whether they go bad or go good, all of them work for good. But you don't see it when it's happening. You see it at the end of the journey. Are we together? You look back. So to be a follower means that even if you can see, you are like the Mau Mau era, you can see clear. If I don't take this oath, I'm dying. You ask yourself, who do I know better than God? If God wants me to go home, who am I to ask to remain on earth? A
I want to do God's way. So you go up and say, what a fool. You are not a fool. You are in God's hands. Am I communicating? You are doing a business to do it in a clean way. Clearly, you will lose the contract. You will lose the tender. And yet you know the voice of God is saying, this is the way to go. You know very well. You actually follow your route and you lose the tender. I now do business. So I make quotation. I do consultant's work and I quote. And you quote in a certain way. Then you can't get. Then somebody advises, if only we had done it this other way, but that other way will not honor God. Say, no, I'm okay. I'm willing to do without that tender. Why? Every tender I win is because God wants me to win. Why would I want to win a tender that God does not want me to? What will happen if something goes wrong with the tender? Who would I cry to when I went in a tender without God's permission? Okay, in the fear? Now you need to understand, following Jesus means understanding that he knows, but number two, he cares for you. And so he cannot allow anything in your life unless he knows how it will turn out for good. So, Samuel is saying, don't you know, to obey is better than sacrifice. So my sister, it doesn't matter how much you have sacrificed in the past. Is there an area in your life where you know the way you are going is not the way God wants you to go? Every other area, you are such a wonderful sister, but there's an area where you are not going to follow him. He either wants all of you or none of you. And it will be important that you ask in your mind, what is it that you want God to do in your life? If you know what you want to do, the way to get it done is to give yourself to the Lord. I have to be finishing. But I want to share quite a few things about discipleship. First, I want to read for you what discipleship is. Christian discipleship is the process by which disciples grow in the Lord Jesus Christ. So if you are a disciple, you are a follower, and you will grow closer to him with time. Number two, in discipleship, you are equipped by the Holy Spirit. So discipleship is getting equipped so that you can deal with the challenges of the evil one. And you are able because the Holy Spirit will reside in your heart. And thirdly, discipleship helps you to overcome the pressures and trials of the present life. So discipleship prepares you to deal with the pressures of the life and become more and more Christ-like. So what is to be a disciple? To be a disciple is to be like the master. So much that people can't tell the difference. In Acts chapter 13, the Bible tells us, people looked at the disciples and they say, this ones look like Christ. So they called them Christians. So in the book of Acts we learn, and the disciples were first called Christians at Antioch. They never called themselves, but they were so like them, you could tell they are related. So if you truly are a disciple, the people in your office, the people in your home, the people in your neighborhood can suspect that you're a Christian. You need to give a proper testimony to confirm. But even before you confirm, they already suspect you are a Christian. You know, a number of things will come out when you become a disciple. Number one, according to Mark chapter 8, verse 34 and 38, you will learn to put Jesus first in all things. Every decision you make will not be your decision. It will be something you consult God. And there will be nothing too big to ask God. And there will be nothing too small to ask. You know, the God of the Kikuyus was never disturbed in small things. We only face Mount Kenya when there is a drop or a big thing. He was such a modose. You didn't bother him. So when you have small problems, you sacrifice to Goma, you know, the spirit of the dead. They handle small problems. You are just disturbing a cough. You don't disturb God. Deal with the spirits. The God of Christianity wants to be disturbed by the smallest problem you have. My wife teaches me because she loses a pen or keys and she's praying. I say, no, look for them. No, let me first ask God. I'm sure enough she finds them. I learned that there is nothing too small
to ask from the Lord. Because you put him first in all things. Back to our song. I surrender all. So it means you have to, if you truly become a disciple, you must put first, Jesus first, in the way you deal with your spouse, the way you deal with your children, the way you deal with your subordinates, the way you deal with your bosses, the way you deal with your community, the way you deal with the police. You must put Jesus first. The disciple of Christ need to be set apart from the world. Because you are putting first. People will not be like you. Have you wondered why sometimes non-Christians don't feel comfortable with you? You know, sometimes you hear a non-Christian saying, I like the Christianity of so-and-so. If you like your Christianity, watch out. Because there is a likelihood you are not following the master. Because when you follow the master, you will be so different from them. They will not want to be with you too much. Are we together? So, because we are learning when you put Jesus first, it will mean you will hurt other people. They will ask you to do something, and then you have a difficulty. Still remember, as a young man in Kericho, we were with a non-Christian and we were working together. Then, I don't know, he was very well known in Kericho town. So, we were in Kericho Tea Hotel. And I was a young man, not too long from the university. And I don't know what they were saying, and I could give them facts straight from my head. I mean, I wonder if these old people don't seem to understand economics. After some time, one of the big men said, wait a minute. Young man, that is clearly good. You must have a task on me. Now, realize, as a young man, I'm also very happy that the big people think I'm great. Now, how do I am born again, I have no intention of taking tasks. But how do I tell a big man, and I'm a young man, that I can't take that? As I say, no, can I have a Fanta? They say, no, my money doesn't buy such nonsense. No. And you sit there, having to make a choice between getting respect and respecting these people, or standing with Jesus. I finally had to say, sir, I can't take that, I am born again. The man quarreled me. Why did you tell me from the beginning? Then have that which thing. Now, I took my Fanta. You remember, in those days, in the 70s, we used to say Fanta stands for foolish Africans. Never take alcohol. Fanta. Now, so I agreed, I'm a fool. I'm not communicating. But it means that I learned my lesson in the 1970s. The better of being non-Christian, let them know who you are. And because they respect you, they'll never lead you to sin. I remember another time I was entertaining some people and we were together in a hotel. It was my budget in being used. And then when the waiter was collecting orders, I ordered my foolish African. And everybody ordered whatever they wanted. When the waiter came, they forgot. And they brought Tasca to me. They brought it to my table. My workmates all of a sudden said, hey, wait a minute. You are going the wrong direction. Do not give him. And the other one said, no. So the alcohol had to be rolled on the other side. I discovered my non-Christian workmates are my protector. Even if I want to backside and taste it, they can't allow me. When you put Jesus first, it means that even your non-Christian friends will be happy to work with you because they know the limits. Am I right?
Yes.
So, he will be the first and will set you apart. You cannot claim to follow the Lord and you are following the world. You have to make a choice. Is to follow Jesus or follow the world. Our focus should be on our Lord and pleasing him in every area of our lives. We must put off self-centeredness and become Christ-centered. If you like big words, we must cease to be egocentric and become Christocentric. That means in your life, you revolve around Christ. Number two, if you truly become a disciple, you become a follower of Jesus' teachings. Now, what we are learning is that if Jesus is truly the one in charge, then you cannot know him without reading his word. You know, in the book of John chapter 1, he says, in the beginning was the word. In verse 14, it says, and the word became flesh and dwelt among us. So the other name for Jesus is the word. So you can never say, I love Jesus.
The next question is, when did you last read the Bible?
Oh, last year.
Now we know how much you love the Lord. Because the Bible and Jesus are the same thing.
You cannot love Jesus more than you love his word.
2 Peter 2:2 says, like newborn babies, desire the sincere milk of the word.
So when you are a disciple, you become somebody desirous of God's word.
A mother, if the baby is newborn and does not want to suck on milk 1 day, 2 days, you'd have to be a very bad mother if by that day you don't take the child to a hospital. Would you agree with me? Because the baby automatically desires milk. Similarly, when you discover that you used to read God's word, you no longer read it. Sometimes you can go a week without reading. Family altar is forgotten. Life is so busy. With 844, when can you read the Bible? And you are having so many contracts. You come home tired. You have no time to read God's word. Let me tell you, if you have no desire to read God's word, you have a spiritual problem. And like a baby whose mother had to be taken to hospital, you need to rush. Don't walk. You need to rush to hospital. Not the Kenyatta or Nairobi hospital, a spiritual hospital. Are we together? One of the ways of knowing you're a backslider is lack of desire to read God's word. Because when you become a Christian, there's a deep desire to know the master. How can you obey the master if you don't even know his instructions? And his instructions are in God's word. Remember, you're talking about discipleship. How to be a good disciple? You must desire God's word. Let me ask you, have you bought your this year's daily guide? A devotional guide to help you read the Bible? Oh, I forgot. Now, surely, the fact that you forgot and you never forgot to buy yourself something new for the year just tells us where your mind is, isn't it? Because something you value, you never lack time. When you hear your friend tell you, oh, I'm still so busy, I've not come to see you. What they are telling you is that between you and what they do is more important than you. It's only they are being kind. That's why they are not telling you. But I can tell you, you never lack time for what you value. People kept asking me, you work for a multinational and you are running everywhere, you are able to preach. How do you cope? I tell you, what you value, you always have time for. Just like you find people that are busy, but they never fail to go to Karomaido. How can you get time? You are such a senior executive. Oh, I can't help it. I must go to Karomaido because Karomaido is their master. Am I communicating? If Jesus says you are master, you can never lack time to listen to God's word. First of all, to read it for yourself, but also to come to church. Are we together? So that's the second day. The third day, if you truly are a disciple, it will be seen by your fruitfulness. You cannot be a disciple and you're not fruitful. We can't see. You say, but I'm a Christian in my own way. Now, remember, a fruit tree never benefits itself. It always benefits others. Am I together? Plant, like the Muru people, where our singer comes from, they plant plants, isn't it? But you cannot always tell about the plant because around December, you see them red everywhere. Am I right? But that plant tree has never eaten fruit. It grew, then they took it for us to eat. It's the same way your Christian life does not benefit you. It benefits the people around you. So when you become a Christian, your wife will tell. She will eat the fruit. Your children will tell. They will eat the fruit. Your workmates will tell. Your fruitfulness is not something you can help. Like I told you about Armstrong, the astronaut. The wife became a Christian. The husband could notice. Am I right? That's what you're talking about. So look at your life. You are even waiting when I'm going to finish for you to go to the things that don't honor God. After all, you have already paid up. You know, in other words, in order to, you know, I saw something written that you can sin 6 days, as long as the seventh, they can be cleared, back to clean slate and sin again. Now, if that is what you are, please sin properly, even on Sunday. Don't start thinking that you'll help. Because the issue is not forgiveness. God will forgive your sins, but you are back to them. Like a pig. You know, you clean up the pig, it runs back to the mud. Am I right? The only solution is getting born again. So the Lord can be. So we are saying there needs to be fruitfulness. That is John chapter 15, verse 5 to 8. Next, If you truly are a disciple, you love other disciples. Something tells me, the other day I was going to for a conference in the Philippines, and we were landing in various places to be able to connect to Manila. And when you are in the airport, these big, huge airports, you wonder which direction. Until you hear somebody else saying, I'm going to Manila. Now you stick there. Something makes you attracted to somebody going where you are. So if you don't feel a desire to be in fellowship, the house group, the district, you live in the same district, but you can never join the district, please start suspecting there is a problem spiritually. Because one of the marks that you are truly a disciple is that you love other disciples. You want to associate with them. If they love your Christ, they are your brothers. Am I right? They may not come from your denomination. The critical thing is not your denomination. The critical thing, are they going to heaven? Once you hear he's also going to heaven and he loves your master, you want to be related with him. Are we together? So if you truly are talking about discipleship, it will be very, very important that you are able to tell. Let me finish with this. If you are a disciple, then of necessity, you'll also obey the Great Commission. And the Great Commission is in Matthew 28, verse 19. He says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very age of the age. How much we covered the final part. Oh God, be with me. What you don't realize is that for God to be with you, there are conditions, isn't it? Number one condition is you must become a disciple yourself. Yourself. You must be, and you have just been talking about. Number two, you must be involved in the business of making
disciples.
Then, lo, I'm with you always. So a disciple is not only somebody who follows Christ, but as a person who helped the Lord to also make disciples. And it's unfortunate I've run out of time. But let me tell you something. Women are the best example I know. If you go to a shop in town and discover a dress, just the right material, at the right price, I doubt that whether all your friends by the end of the week will not have known. You are just walking, then you haven't told Mama Kayuki. Yeah, have you heard? There's a material in town. Then you say, then you are doing something. And then you say, have you heard? Why? If you're in love with people, you want what is good. Am I right?
Yes.
Question mark. If you truly love Christ, how come people don't know about it? There are only three possibilities. Number one, they are not your friends. So you don't mind even if they will go to hell. Because if you truly have workmates, you admire them, you love them, how would you want them to go to hell? Never. So there's a possibility you hate them. And of course, if you hate them, it also means you are not a disciple. Am I right? There's no way. You know, in 1978, I was speaking in Kenyatta University. Then it was a college, you know, it was a college of University of Nairobi, 1978. And we were having a university mission. And the way we did missions those years in the 70s is as you went to a university, you had a main speaker, and then there are many of us who were assisting. And you'd go to various halls. So after the main hall, you go to various halls of residence, and you stay with the people who want. So we had told a Christian to welcome all the others, and then give teams, they used to say, coffee, tea, and yum-yums. So, and the students love tea. So a lot of non-Christians were in the place. So we say we want to discuss. Some of them did not even go for the main meeting, but they were still there for the tea. So, but I really like university students. As we were busy trying to organize ourselves, one and Christians was already asking questions. He said, you know, you Christians, let's be frank, you don't believe in hell. Hey, the Christian students were up in arms. I said, no, let's first of all get organized. So after it was settled, I told the non-Christian to repeat his question. I do not believe Christians believe in hell. And I want to tell you why. My mother is born again. I've just come from holidays, and I know she's a woman of God. If he really believed I was going to hell, and I stayed there 2 weeks, I'm sure the way my mother loved me, if she knew I was going to hell, she would have certainly told me about the Lord. The fact that she never told me, I don't doubt her love. She has, there's too much evidence about her love for me. What I know, she cannot believe I'm going to hell. And not even that, here in this campus, my roommate is a Christian boy. Always going to morning worship, morning glory they call it. But he has never asked me one day to go with him. And I know as soon as we were put in the same room, we hate it off. We are good pals. And he has never told me about getting born again. Surely, do you think I doubt my friend's love? I know he loves me. What I know, he doesn't believe I'm going to hell. By that time, all the student Christian students went quiet. Now, I'm asking them to reply. You know, they wanted to reply in advance. Now, nobody wanted to reply. And since I was the one to help them, I realized I have to answer the question. You know the truth be told? The reason why you don't share Jesus with others is because you don't believe in him. You don't really believe there is heaven and hell. You cannot allow your own mother to go to hell. You love her too much. Today's Mother's Day. The reason why you can visit her, send her M-Pesa, you know, go and slaughter for her, tell her nothing about Jesus, is because you think the two of you are the same. You are going to the same place. Am I communicating? So it means nothing to you. Disciples are known by the fact that they always become disciples. There is somebody they are witnessing to. If you are not witnessing, it's clear you don't believe in heaven and hell. And you don't believe in Jesus. Sorry, my time has gone. But I want to just ask you, what do you hear God telling you? Because I am now in charge of the whole world. Go and make disciples of all nations. Baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. But that's not the end. And teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. Why? Do not be quick to call somebody a disciple who puts up his hand in a meeting. Oh, I want to get saved. How do you know he is a disciple? If you teach him what the Bible says and he follows it. How do you know that it was a stillbirth? You know what a stillbirth is? When you deliver a baby dead, it's called stillbirth. And many spiritual births are stillbirths. True, somebody put up their hand in a meeting, but their life is the way it was all the time. They have the same boyfriend, they have the same girlfriend, they have the same backbiting women, gossip style. There nothing changes. That tells you it was not a life path. It was a stillbirth. Because when you have a life path, you are taught to follow. Not something, let me read it again, and teaching them to obey. It's not something but everything. All things are commanded to you. And when did he command? All he commanded is already in the Gospels. And the Bible is saying, if you become a disciple, you must follow him in all areas. Let us pray. I want to give you a moment to just, don't worry about somebody else. Yourself, are you truly a disciple? Do you have the marks we are discussing? The way up is the way down. If you don't admit what the Holy Spirit is pointing out your way, then you continue as a rebel. But today, if you tell God, forgive me for times when I have claimed to be born again, but I'm not really surrendered to you. Forgive me. And from now onwards, walk with me. I'm willing to follow you. It will not matter that things have been bad in the past. He will forgive you and walk with you. Or maybe you are not born again, and the Lord is willing to forgive you and to walk with you. Like I've said, when we walk with him, some things will work bad, some things will work good, but whether they work good or work bad, the Lord will make all things to work together for your good. But it all begins by being born again and having yourself to the Lord. Is that when somebody said, Brother Nanga, that was my message. I need God's forgiveness. I want to walk following him. Would you like to put up your hand so that as I pray, I know somebody specific I'm praying for. Just put up your hand. You are showing it to God that you truly want his forgiveness. After I see it, you put it down. The Lord bless you.
Somebody else, the Lord bless you, also put down. Somebody else, the Lord bless you. It's between you and God. Once you put up your hand, you are showing God you truly want his forgiveness. You want him to take over and lead you from here on. Anybody else? The Lord bless you. Put the hand down. Anybody else? I want to ask Dr. Mondia to just commit all of us who have put up our hands into God's hands, that he may truly walk with us as our master.
Indeed, God, I want to thank you because you have